Elk Mound is located just off Interstate 94, only 10 miles from Eau Claire, but its population of 737 attests to the fact that it has been largely unaffected by urban sprawl. The main street, lined mostly by old bungalows and no more than a handful of small businesses, could serve as a Hollywood set for a sleepy, rural, middle America town. So could the high school football field. Situated on top of a hill at the end of Ivy Street north of town, it is shadowed by a woods that glistens in the lights when the maple and oak trees are changing colors on a fall Friday night. The middle of the field has been worn to the point where there is more black dirt than grass. Two 2x10 bare boards serve as the team's benches. The lights hang from old wooden posts no more than 50 feet above the ground, and the only bleachers are spaced along the sidelines in six small sections, only 5 rows high.
When the Elk Mound School District was created in 1920, basketball was the first sport offered for both boys and girls. School-sponsored baseball and track teams came into existence sometime later. Besides a male club volleyball team, these three sports would be the only athletic offerings during the first 44 years of the school's existence. For years, the baseball and track teams practiced and played on the battlefield, an area on the west side of the current middle school. Basketball was played in a crowded cracker box of a gym located in the basement of the school. In the 1950s, with the basketball team enjoying a decade of success, the deteriorating cramped quarters of the Mounders' basement court could no longer serve the needs of the team or community. On December 1, 1955, to the delight of 600 fans, the first game was played in the new gym. With one facility issue solved, the school board turned its attention away from athletics and began initial discussions about the consolidation of the Elk Mound and Springbrook schools. A group of community members concerned about the woeful lack of an athletic field for Fayette and baseball, and wanting the addition of football as an extracurricular offering, were eyeing the Springbrook consolidation carefully. School enrollment was increasing. Class sizes were approaching 45 students per class at the lower levels. Increasing enrollment would demand more offerings and expanded facilities. In the minds of the athletic field supporters, a historically conservative Board of Education would most certainly address the brick-and-mortar needs before an athletic field. On July 8th of 1957, nearly 80 community members attended the annual school board meeting. A motion was made by Boyd Christofferson and seconded by Reverend Bryce to authorize the Board of Education to purchase land for an athletic field. Jewel Root amended the motion to include the election of a committee of 5 community members to assist the board in finding a site. Those present that evening wanted a more aggressive approach. The citizenry promptly denied the amendment and made a substitute motion that included not only the formation of a committee that would find a suitable site, but also directed the board to reconvene a special meeting within 6 weeks to approve the purchase. The motion carried 48-29, with two abstentions. The committee, made up of Jewel Rood, Ms. Gerhard Price, Clarence Gerking, Roland Owis, and Tony Schrantz, set to work finding a suitable tract of land. After considering the Osmond property, located at the east end of the village and south of Highway 12, the committee, school board, and village met to discuss a second option, a piece of property on the southern slope of the mound that had been donated years prior to the district. On September 24, 1957, with Jewel Root speaking on behalf of the committee, a special meeting of the school board was held. A motion was passed to adopt the Mound Hill site for the development of the new athletic field. Within 2 weeks of the vote, the board contracted with Elmer Watland, an excavator from Menominee, to clear the timber, level the ground, and spread topsoil at a cost of approximately $5,000, with a recently built gym and a new athletic field underway. The school facilities had the opportunity to grow along with the school population. The site was ready to use by the fall of 1958. In the spring of 59, the Mounder baseball team was the first to play on the field. For the first 5 years of existence, the field was not only a baseball diamond, but also served as the practice area for track. Two lanes were chalked so sprinters and distance runners could train. In addition, the added space allowed Fayette classes to add activities such as archery to the curriculum. And by 1970, the Girls Athletic Association used the field for track practice and to host speedball contests against fellow Dunn St. Croix schools. Little did the board and the athletic committee realize that when they developed the land in 1957, that within the next decade, a sport would be added out of necessity that would impact the history of the school in a major way. The addition of football as a sport can indirectly be traced to the consolidation of the Owen and Withy school districts. In 1955, the combining of the two schools left an opening for a school in the Eastern Clover Belt. Gilman jumped at the opportunity to switch, leaving the Western Clover Belt with only four schools. In 1956, 1 year after Owen and Withy consolidated, Gilman switched to the Eastern Clover Belt and Elk Mound was extended an invitation to replace them in the western half of the conference. A Leader Telegram article from February of 1956 stated that Elk Mound fits well into the Western Clover Belt, noting that the longest road trip would be only as far as Cornell, and that the addition of the Mounders would make the conference a solid quintet of basketball schools. Elk Mound was thrilled at the chance to save travel time and compete in a strong basketball conference that included Altoona and Fall Creek. Beginning in the 1956-57 school year, Elk Mound began its short and unheralded tenure in the Western Clover Belt. Almost 5 years to the date of their departure from the DSC, Elk Mound returned. The great experiment in the Clover Belt did not pan out as anticipated. In February of 1961, realignment, once again, provided the district the opportunity to switch their affiliation. Starting in the 1961-62 school year, Hammond and Roberts combined, forming the St. Croix Central School District. The consolidation left a hole in the conference that Elk Mound was eager to fill. The conference was now sponsoring football, and a stipulation was added by the DSC schools that Elk Mound must add the sport within 3 years or their membership would be terminated. On February 13, 1961, after a report by Principal Haug, the board voted unanimously to switch from the Clover Belt to the Dunn St. Croix. There was no recorded mention in the board minutes of the conversation between Haug and the board regarding the stipulation which required Elk Mound to add football by the fall of 1964. With Elk Mound securely back in the DSC fold, the school moved forward without much thought given to football. 2.5 years later, in the fall of 1963, Matt Bubun, basketball coach, and Principal Manley Olson attended a Dunn St. Croix conference meeting at which Elk Mound adding football was discussed. At the September school board meeting, Bubun and Olson reported that it was pointed out by the conference commissioner, Calvin Tim, of Prescott, that Elk Mound was in the third year of a probationary period and had to decide if they would field a football team, a condition that was made mandatory when they were allowed back into the conference. The school board had avoided the football question for as long as possible. They were now forced to act, and act quickly, or they would be looking for a new conference to compete in. 1 month later, on October 14th of 1963, after a motion was made by Wayne Harrison and seconded by Eldon Dodge, a vote was taken to add football as a sport. After considerable discussion, it passed by a narrow 4-3 vote. Football would become a reality, beginning with the 1964 season. Leveraged by the conference and concerned by a community split over the dangers of adding the sport, it had become apparent that the board's less than resounding approval of football was based primarily on maintaining a conference affiliation. This lack of initial support was evident when in June of 1964, a mere 2 months before the start of practice, it was reported by Principal Bruce Erickson that a football coach had not yet been hired and no uniforms or equipment had been purchased. It took until August to secure Len Gilbert and Ken Koppelman to coach the team. Gilbert had never played football, and Koppelman was new to coaching. The rookie coaches were each paid the sum of $275 for their efforts. The one positive was that the athletic field could accommodate their need for a practice and game facility. The first home high school football game in Elk Mound took place on September 11, 1964. It was a humid and overcast Friday afternoon. The opponent was the Holcomb Chieftains. Along the crowded sidelines, the players mixed in with the crowd and cheerleaders. At halftime, the team found a quiet spot on the hillside to talk strategy. With only a few weeks of practice under their belts, the young Mounders were raw in both their skills and understanding of the game.
I'll never forget Tom Panier, one of the kids, was real fast. In fact, he won, I sent some things in track and field and that kind of stuff. And he was really fast. And I know Len and I had sat down and we worked out the plans. He said, if we can just get him out in the open, around the end somehow, nobody's going to catch him. So that was our basic plan of attack.
The Mounders lost that afternoon, 27-0, to the eventual conference champions. Gilbert and Koppelman realized that their success that season would not be measured on the scoreboard. They were determined instead to find ways to instill confidence and understanding in their inexperienced squad.
We did, you know. Len Gilbert was a good PE teacher and he had all the information there. But he hadn't played football, and I played football, so they made me the assistant. Actually, he did most of the work. What I did, basically, was trying to get the kids started, since we started out with kids that had never, I don't think, touched a football. So we had to work with getting the equipment together, you know, how to put everything on for safety and all that. And then I worked with some of the basic techniques of blocking and tackling and, you know, that kind of thing. So it was a pretty big job, you know, in a short time. Fortunately, we had some really good kids.
Under the patient guidance of the coaches, the team improved each week, and when the season was over, they had secured 2 victories. Thus, the humble beginnings of a storied program had begun. The vision of the 1957 board and athletic supporters of developing an athletic field that could host athletic events and be used in support of physical education and other school-based activities had now become a reality. Their vision provided the facility necessary for the successes that would follow. With baseball well established and football gaining support, the field became a community gathering place on crisp autumn Friday nights and sun-soaked spring afternoons. The amphitheater-type setting brought an intimacy to the contest that few venues anywhere in the region could match. But looking past the nostalgic charm of the location, the complex was rudimentary at best and lacked basic amenities such as dugouts, bathroom facilities, a concession stand, scoreboard, lights, and a parking lot. In the fall of 1967, Larry Plosh took over the football program. Plosh led fundraising efforts to improve the field. By the early 1970s, a scoreboard, along with a storage shed that doubled as a concession stand, were placed on the east end of the field. Lights soon followed and games were moved from the afternoon to the evening.
So we had lights on the field, which was great, and we had a corner, we had a full football field, and then we started looking for a scoreboard because we never had the scoreboard. I see it's still sitting up there in the woods. That was another story. We had to run raffle tickets for that. We finally got a scoreboard on the field.
The original plan of plank seating terraced into the hillside never reached fruition, but portable bleachers on the north and the south sidelines helped ease some of the seating issues for football. Baseball games provided a more unique challenge. Most spectators found a sunny spot on the north and east banks and watched from an elevated perch. The steep hillside provided a challenge to navigate, so a level path was created from the east end of the field along the tree line above where the fans watched the game. The path is still visible today. After several seasons of leading the program, Coach Plosh started homecoming week, which included a bonfire and a snake dance. The Mounder faithful even decorated the goalposts prior to the game.
It took 4 years to get homecoming again. 1 year I got him to let us have, the dance was the last thing. The first thing was we had a parade, see if we get a parade going. Well, if you get, you talk to the police department and stuff, so we finally finagled that. Well, then I thought, well, maybe we can get a bonfire. So we did, we got the bonfires going, you know, and then that was really a lot of fun. Then we got a dance, and Sue O'Neill used to be the art teacher. She was really good. They decorated the gym, and then we had a parade, and then floats, and we finally got the floats in, and they were able to drive trucks and stuff like that. But it took 4 years to get the whole package in, and I mean, it was just a, you know, heck of a good community.
More importantly, the program was beginning to show signs of life. In the fall of 1970, the football team won its first conference championship in the history of the young program. Over the next three decades, the Mounder baseball and football teams would enjoy great success at their field on the base of the mound. Coach Plosh's tenure as football coach ended after the 1973 season when he took a position in the Boyceville School District. With the start of the 1974 season, Dan Peterson was hired to coach the team. The baseball team had gone through a series of coaches during the 1960s and into the early 70s. Stability in the program was established in the mid-70s, starting with Gary Siebel and continuing under the steady hand of Don Miller and his son Scott. During the decades of the 80s and 90s, both programs would establish a level of success rivaled only by the basketball teams that dominated the Dunn-St. Croix in the 1950s. After Coach Plosh left, the field remained unchanged for the next several decades. In the fall of 1976, the Elk Mound School District opened up a new high school. For a period of time, the football team practiced next to the new school in an area that was carved out of a cornfield. They continued to play their home games at Mound Hill Field. In the late 80s and early 90s, the program fulfilled the vision that Coach Peterson had created over a decade earlier. Many victories were gained, and large crowds regularly packed the closely cropped sidelines to watch the Mounder machine in action. The baseball team dominated the Dunn-St. Croix during the decade of the 80s, winning 7 conference championships, 5 regional crowns, and 1 sectional title. The hard work of Don and Scott Miller was evident as the long-term success of the baseball program culminated in a state championship in 1995. The field played host during the spring and summer months to endless rounds of youth and Legion games. The program continued to be highly successful under the guidance of Eric Hansen and Paul Andrea. By the mid-80s, the field was beginning to show its age. As high school sports began to evolve, expectations for better and safer facilities grew. Limited seating for both sports, poor drainage on the baseball field, and no permanent restrooms were emblematic of the growing list of problems with the facility. In the early 1990s, due to liability concerns, a concrete retaining wall was built into the side of the hill behind the baselines from first to third. Around that time, a safety fence and dugouts were added for the protection of the players. Concerns regarding player safety began to be raised in football as well. The crowded end zone corners, shallow sidelines with no protective barriers between the players and fans, and limited ambulance accessibility all became pronounced issues. By the early 1990s, Superintendent Bill Vincent and Athletic Director Jay Silvernail spearheaded the effort to relocate the football field to the high school campus. In the fall of 1991, the football team played its last game at Mound Hill Field. The baseball team continued to play on the field through 2005 before moving to the Village Park for home games. Since then, varsity events have no longer been played there. Shortly after baseball ceased playing at the field, the lights were dismantled and the press box torn down. Besides mowing the grass, the district no longer maintains the site. Serving as a middle school practice and play area, the field is still in use, but Mother Nature has taken its toll. The hillside is filling with trees and bushes, and the infield is no longer dirt. In time, the field will cease to exist. The mound will reclaim it as its own. The memories, however, will remain forever of the shortstop turning two, the quarterback rolling out on a bootleg, the sprinter rounding the curve and heading for home. Sometimes dusty, sometimes muddy, this bug-infested, pie-shaped piece of turf, carved from the hill on the north end of Ivy Street, has served the school and community well. Season after season, fans crowded the sidelines and reclined on the hillsides, witnessing their fair share of joyous victories and agonizing defeats. Countless numbers of Elk Mound athletes learned the finer points of running, blocking, hitting, and pitching on its grass and dirt. More importantly, it is a place where leaders developed, work ethic was taught, camaraderie shared, and lessons learned. 6 decades have passed since the annual meeting vote that changed the course of Elk Mound athletics. Who would have thought that a $5,000 investment would have provided such a large return in human capital that it could never be measured or repaid?
It was a beautiful place to play. I mean, here we sit in at the bottom of a hill in Elk Mound. I mean, all the colors were on display in the fall, and the bleachers were there, and behind them, there was all the grade school kids had their own game of football going, playing back and forth, and so it was just a wild, wild time, and it was very good.
But back in here, you can't even see the hill here now, but we'd run hill charges up there, and oh, that was tough. I don't know how some of these bigger guys didn't break a leg coming down, but boy, if that didn't get you in shape. And then there were always some couple pine trees on top of the hill, and a couple guys would hide behind those, and so you could try and skip a few. Well, he caught on to that too, so we'd have to do a couple extras.
You know what I remember about baseball when you're just bringing this up? I'm just trying to think. I remember playing in baseball where you have an out-of-play line off to the side. No fence or anything like that. The ball gets by. Bruce Myers, Bruce is playing third base. We're playing here. Bruce was a great athlete, but not always didn't have great baseball knowledge. He's playing third base, and the ball comes dribbling down third, and it's just barely foul. And everybody's yelling at him, Bruce, keep it foul, keep it foul. Bruce, the ball's like, all of a sudden, by the time he gets to it, it's rolled fair, and he thought they said, kick it, foul. He winds up, kicks it out of play. You know, I don't know how many, but somebody scored, the guy hits the second, you know, you're just the little things that you're not going to get at any other field anymore, you know.
On the old baseball field and the be muddy, and it wasn't real good, but we thought it was great. No, it was just fun, a lot of fun.
It was a cool place to be. You know, because it was tight with fans, it didn't take a lot of people to totally fill it. It was full. You'd come up here on a Friday night or something, and if you had 500 people, they'd line this side. You know, they'd fill the place.
I can still remember running a rollout with Al Erickson leading and I didn't get touched for 60 yards. I mean, I can remember turning around and looking, and the guys were smiling and laughing as we're going into the end zone. There was
always something going on. You know, there might be 2-on-2 football at this end. There might be a wiffle ball game against the fence, but there was always activity, like there is right now. You know, there's stuff going on, activity. It was just a wonderful place to be on a Friday night. It was cozy, it was everything else. Just growing up here, it was used every night. We had people in our backyard every night. You know, every night there was something going on. And as a kid, what a wonderful thing. I could walk out the door, there was always people, there was always something going on. You know, always something.
This place, how about old school it was, and how those lights looked like candlesticks burning on top of sticks, and how the bleachers were nothing more than just 5 rows of wooden bleachers, and he talked about it, but he talked about it not to make fun of it, but because it was a very special place, and just like it was, a very special place.
Thank you. see. As Mommy Bobby returned, oh, how my heart did yearn for you and the day that used to be. My life has flown.